normally what I'm going to be talking to you about, I do it as a slideshow, and I normally take 1 hour, though I prefer to do it over 1.5 hours, hundreds of slides. When I was asked to come here and talk to you at this program, I was told I have 18 minutes. So I decided to dispense with the visuals. And I'll try to finish whatever I have to say in the 18 minutes, of which 1 minute is gone. Now basically I'm going to be talking about some very commonplace things. The lotus, the swastika, the kalash, and something that is known as the Yantra, which is two triangles superimposed one on top of the other. And through these, I am trying to look at architecture, medieval architecture, and see how these have gotten absorbed in medieval architecture. Now before I proceed, I just want to make one small, raise one question. All of you must have read or heard the term Islamic architecture. And large number of books have been written on Islamic architecture. Do you remember any book on Christian architecture? Or on Hindu architecture? If there is no Christian architecture, and if there is no Hindu architecture, how can you have Islamic architecture? This is a process of creating the other, which has presented us with this strange word called Islamic architecture. I can talk endlessly on that, but I'll just leave a couple of things with you. If you were to be asked what is Islamic architecture, you would say the dome, the arch, and the minaret. All of you must be now on Google. Somebody as old as I am is on Google, so all of you would be. When you get the time next time, look for the dome in Google. And look for the oldest dome. And you'll realize that it was made by the Romans. Romans in the time before the birth of Christ. And before they made the dome, they made the arch. So the dome and the arch, which are presented to us as Islamic architecture, have nothing to do with Islam. They were born before the birth of Christ. So just remember this. And now I am coming to the core symbol that I have talked to you about. Now, I don't really need to talk about these, because all, you know, in India we know all of this. But I'm just trying to make some connections. When I mentioned the lotus, all of you would have imagined images of Indian deities inside the lotus. Vishnu in the lotus. Durga, Lakshmi, and Kartike, Ganesh. I have images of Shiva in the lotus. All the gods in the lotus. Buddha in the lotus. Mahavir Jain in the lotus. Buddhism travels to Tibet and they create a feminine Buddha, and she is placed in the lotus. And then there is a further development of a Buddha that will be Buddha that will come in future, and he is also, his image is also placed in the lotus. Now why are all of them in the lotus? And this is what got me thinking. I think what happened, much before we had imagined these gods, when we dwelled in the forest, maybe not even in India, in somewhere in Africa. That is where all humanity began its journey. We used to venerate the spirit of the forest, the spirit of the mountain, the spirit of the rock. And we treated these as living things. The forest, when the mountain got angry, you had a volcanic eruption. When the forest got angry, you had a fire, etc., etc. They were all these beliefs. And therefore, you had to appease these, the forest, the mountain, the spirit, and the ritual of offering, making small offerings to mountains, to rivers, to forests began. It's around that time that I believe, and I believe it was a woman who thought of it first. Walking through an open space, she comes across an open little pond with the stagnant pond with rotting vegetation in it, with mud, yucky, sticky, and in that a lotus. And she looks at that lotus and says to herself that you can rise above all this and be pure. Why I say it was a woman? Because I believe that women notice these things much before men do. They look at the details. And it is then that the lotus becomes a symbol of beauty. Much, much later, we imagined gods. And gods had to sit in a place which was pure. And that is why all of them were placed in the lotus. Across, every god inside the lotus. How does it happen? There cannot be any other explanation to my mind except this, that the veneration of the lotus predates the creation of gods. Then we imagine these gods, each with their own attributes, and we place them inside the lotus. Then we started making temples, and on top of the temple, right on top of the gopura, we carved the lotus. We also carved a form which is known as the amalaka, which is like a gear, a wheel with serrated edges. That wheel represents the lotus, the sun, and the throne of gods. And that's why it was placed on top of temple. Look for amalaka in Google and you will get thousands of images of the amalaka. This is 3-in-1, lotus, sun and the throne of gods. I will come back to it later. Then there is the Kalash. Now, Kalash is such a fascinating form and it is so versatile. How did it come into existence? Not before we had begun to settle down, not before we had stopped wandering around and started making villages on the banks of rivers, and that is when we started making pottery. And each civilization was identified by its pottery. The Roman amphoras, the Grecian urns, the terracotta of the Indus Valley civilization, each civilization had pottery that was unique to them. We started making terracotta pots, kalash, ghada, and we started storing water in it. The moment it became a storage for water, it came to represent sustenance, because there is no life without water. So the kalash became a symbol of sustenance. We started agriculture, we harvested our crops. Where do you keep the crop? We made really huge earthenware pots. They were known as storage bins, and we stored our crops in them to protect them from insects. And you took out some as you wanted to consume and the rest remained in the large urn. We also made small urns and we stored seed for the next crop separately. Because the kalash had seed in it, it came to represent the womb. वो गर्भ, इसलिए उसे गर्भ कलश कहते हैं. द मोमेंट इट केम टू रिप्रेजेंट द वूम, इट बिगेन टू बी यूज्ड इन फर्टिलिटी रिचुअल. आप सब लोगों ने देखा होगा, मुझे पता नहीं आपने कभी गौर किया कि नहीं, शादी में दो कलश और उसके ऊपर नारियल क्यों रखा होता है? ये फर्टिलिटी का सिंबल है. जब शादी होती है, मुझे पूरे भारत का नहीं पता लेकिन उत्तर भारत में सर्टनली होता है, आफ्टर अ वेडिंग एक रसम होती है गोद भराई की. अमंग द थिंग्स दैट आर प्लेस्ड इन द लैप ऑफ द न्यूली मैरिड गर्ल इज अ कोकोनट. व्हाई? द कोकोनट इज ऑल्सो रिप्रेजेंटेटिव ऑफ द वूम बिकॉज इट हैज लाइफ इन इट. दीज आर सिंबल्स ऑफ फर्टिलिटी. लाइक ऑल एंशियंट सिविलाइजेशंस, we began as worshippers of fertility. Because childbirth was something that human beings did not understand. How did it happen? When the sexual urge came on them, they made love and then they went their own way. There were no family at that time. 9 months later, the child was born. Where did he come from? They created a god of childbirth. We created a goddess, Mata. Har gaon mein ek Mata ka mandir hota hai. She is the presiding deity of that village. She is a fertility goddess. Just as in Europe they had Zeus, they had Aphrodite, they had Venus, they had Electra, they had all these gods and goddesses. They are all fertility goddesses. All ancient civilizations created gods of birth and death. So we also created them. And gradually we started building temples. And in the temples we carved the Kalash. Because some of our earliest temples were temples to goddess of fertility. And then the Kalash became a permanent fixture in temple architecture. I'll return to it again. The third thing is the swastika. We are constantly told that swastika is an Indian invention. It is not. Nobody knows who thought of the swastika first. Again, go to Google and search for swastika. You will get hundreds of images of the swastika. There are Christian swastikas. There are swastika that have been used in the countries where now Muslims live. But earlier they were pagans like everywhere else. Aztec Indians in America, on their tents you will find the swastika. And they had no connection to the Indians here. Astronomers and people who are studying these phenomena increasingly are coming round to the idea that the swastika actually has a connection to the fourth star. Where the four arms meet, that is where the pole star is, and these four arms of the swastika represent the Saptarishi in there, because in a 24-hour cycle the Saptarishi go around the north pole, the pole star. It is this that is symbolically represented as the swastika. Now these three things, and the fourth is the six-cornered star. We are told this is the star of David. And David is a prophet of the Muslims. In the time of Jesus, he is mentioned as an ancestor of Jesus. In the time of Moses, there is no mention of David. It is possible that the star of David traveled with the Muslims and came to India. But something totally different is also possible. The six-cornered star in India is known as the Adi Yantra. This triangle represents feminine energy and this triangle represents masculine energy. And these two superimposed inside the circle represent the universe in harmony. Is it the Adi Yantra or the star of David? Or is it just two equilateral triangles that every civilization has used? I was talking to a preschool teacher and she told me when a child picks up a brush or a pencil to draw a star for the first time in their life, they always draw a six-cornered star, never a five-cornered star. This is something that comes naturally to human beings. Just as we have six notes in music, all over the world, the same six notes. These are things that unite entire humanity. I have 3 minutes left. I'll just sum it up now. 2 minutes actually. The lotus, the kalash, the six-cornered star and the swastika, all of them have been used profusely in medieval architecture. Go to Humayun's tomb, go to the Jama Masjid, right on top of the Jama Masjid, what do you see on top of the dome? One large kalash, one small kalash and a cone. The cone represents the coconut. This used to be on top of temples. It began to be used in domes in the 16th century. Before that, all over the city, look at the old ruins, you will find all kinds of lotus forms on top of domes. When the dome came to India, the Indian Indian builder was extremely unhappy because it ended abruptly. They gradually began to add ornamentation. The first thing they added was the amalaka that I was talking to you before. Then they added the lotus. And then now they added the kalash in the 16th century. Go to Fatehpur Sikri, I don't know whether you've been there. Fatehpur Sikri is filled with swastikas. Filled with swastikas. Go to the mausoleum of Akbar. On the main gate, there are 8 large swastikas. 4 outside, 4 inside. Go to the mausoleum of Kulli Khan in Mehrauli. There are 4 arches. Each arch is studded with swastikas. The swastika was not a Hindu symbol. The kalash was not a Hindu symbol. The six-cornered star was not a Hindu symbol. These were Indian symbols. It is the British who designed them, started calling them Hindu symbols, and they started calling the architecture that had come from Central Asia as Islamic architecture. So this is where the disruption is. My time is up, so I'll just leave you with these questions. Question every single category that has been given to you, especially those that have been created by Anglo-Saxon scholarship. Thank you.